The concept of nanotechnology started with Feynman and his famous speech, "There is plenty of room at the bottom." The presentation was a huge success. The idea was simple. There is so much room for technology to improve by going smaller. If you could make something that can store a bit of information a million times smaller, you can fit a million times as much information in a given space. Put it simply, if you can manipulate matter at the nanoscale, you can make technology that is effectively a million times more powerful. And this was an idea that was completely unexplored. Nowadays, nanotech is old news. Everyone has heard of its immense promise, from giving people superpowers to curing diseases like cancer. However, why stop there? There is even more room at the bottom than even Feynman could have imagined. Why not make technology that is a billion times more powerful, or a trillion, a quadrillion, a quintillion, than nanotech? Now, there is nothing significant about a picometer. It is between the size of a nucleus and an atom. However, there is a near infinite potential for femtotech. If nanotech is a million times stronger, femtotech is a trillion times stronger. And this is an idea that is almost completely unexplored. Anything you've seen before, any object you can even think of, is made of electrons, protons, and neutrons. Each proton and neutron is, probably, made of just three quarks, specifically up and down quarks. However, these are not the only subatomic particles that exist. There's an entire periodic table of particles for us to play with. Why limit ourselves to just three? Now, the reason these other particles are not used is because they are unstable and collapse instantly in most circumstances. One of the most important principles in chemistry is the Pauli exclusion principle. It states that two identical fermions cannot simultaneously occupy the same quantum state within a system. This means we have a handful of quantum numbers which cannot match. They are analogous to coordinates in our world. No two objects can have the same x, y, and z coordinates at the same time. The space the objects can be in gives us all the possible coordinates they could have, which we can then map. Similarly, electrons have these quantum coordinates, n, l, and m. And mapping the space these quantum states can occupy gives us the periodic table. Now, of course, not every state has the same energy level. Particles will want to occupy the lower energy state and won't take higher energy states unless the lower ones are filled up. As you add electrons, you go farther down the periodic table. Quarks and nucleons also follow the principles. They do not want to be higher generation quarks because they are much higher energy level and therefore unstable. But matter in extreme conditions has to manage it. Imagine you had a room full of bowling balls. If you were to shrink the room, eventually, you reach a point where there is no more space. If you decide to push farther, you start forcing them higher up. Similarly, with enough pressure, you force the nucleons and even quarks into higher energy states. This is called degenerate matter. If you stop applying the force, the balls will force their way out. Similarly, outside of these high pressures like a neutron star, degenerate matter will decay into normal matter. The amount of force required to keep them in these higher energy states depends on how much higher in energy the state is. It has been hypothesized that strange quark matter could exist in neutron stars and then be stable under normal conditions in so-called strangelets, which can decay normal matter into more of itself. This is part of an entire class of particles called hypernucleons. If we could manipulate quarks on the femtoscale to make these stable, we could have tons of different kinds of nucleons, amounting to a limitless number of new elements. Another form of hypothetical matter that can be created in extreme conditions and stable in more relaxed conditions is what they call up-down quark matter. Here, the quarks are free-flowing in the nucleus, not bound in protons and neutrons. It has been proposed that this would allow for an entire extra region of the periodic table, past 300 atomic mass of stable elements. Essentially, periodic table DLC. This continent of stability is much closer in reach for us. The Large Hadron Collider is even being used to search for it right now. Just think about the complexities of life. All of this is done with a handful of elements. And imagine what we could do with 10,000 more. I plan on doing videos both on the unique properties of elements in the continent of stability and on hypernuclear elements. We have all heard of the promise of fusion energy. It is the future of energy, always 30 years in the future to be exact. Now, if you take something that is far away from a pulling force, such as gravity, it has potential energy, proportional to the strength of the force and the distance. As the object is pulled towards the force, the potential energy is converted to other forms. Now, direct comparison isn't quite accurate, but the strong nuclear force, the force that holds the nucleon together, is said to be about 100 trillion 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 times stronger than gravity. So when two hydrogen nucleuses are allowed to get together, the potential energy is converted to other forms. And due to the strength of the nuclear force, that is a lot of energy. Quarks are also pulled together by the nuclear force, so you can imagine they can also be used for fusion. A paper by Merrick Carliner and Jonathan Rosner propose a method to do something analogous to classical fusion using quarks. They say, "We suggest some experimental setups in which the highly exothermic nature of the fusion of two heavy quark baryons might manifest itself. At present, however, the very short lifetimes of the heavy bottom and charm quarks preclude any practical application of such reaction. A baryon is a particle of three quarks. Essentially, if we could get baryons with two of these heavier quarks, we could get a reaction that produces 8 times as much energy as classical fusion." The late Dr. Alexander Belokhin proposed a method to make a special type of degenerate matter stable under normal conditions. This involved arranging the protons and neutrons in a lattice configuration to minimize the repulsive force between positively charged protons and the chance of weak decay, all while maximizing the strong force attraction. He called this AB matter. Now, the specifics are untested. Belokhin is a real scientist who taught in university, but nuclear physics was not his field of expertise, and no other papers have been published on his stabilization methods. Though I know of no immediate problems, this gives us reason to be skeptical of it. However, his papers on the applications of AB matter have been peer-reviewed in applicable journals, so I will focus on that. The most obvious feature AB matter has is its extreme strength that results from the extreme strength of the nuclear force, and its high density. The figure usually given for the percent of empty space in an atom is 99.999999999996%. AB matter makes use of much more of the space, giving it unimaginable properties. He writes, "AB matter is stronger by a factor of 10 to the 23rd times than steel." The paper continues, "This is worth your attention. A thread having a diameter 100,000 times less than an atom's diameter can suspend a weight nearly of human mass. With that unfathomable strength, we can make a space elevator, and even that is thinking too small. It can also survive extreme temperatures with a cited failure temp of around 70 billion degrees Kelvin, allowing it to even be used for construction in Phoenix, Arizona. AB matter would completely revolutionize energy. AB matter is supposed to be stable because it is a lower energy state than regular matter. As explained previously, when something goes into lower energy state, that energy must be released, effectively meaning a fancy form of fusion happens in the reaction of AB matter. Besides creating energy, Belokhin says it can also store energy. He writes, "The energy saved by a flywheel equals the special mass density of material. This means just 2 grams of degenerate flywheels can be used to store enough energy for a car for its entire lifetime. Flywheels usually have to contend with friction on the axis and the air. However, AB matter doesn't have such weaknesses. Friction results from the imperfections of the surface interacting with another surface or the air. Since AB matter is smooth on the femto scale, it would have no friction to speak of. This also makes it ideal for aircraft. Immense energy storage and the ability to go unhindered also makes it ideal for long-distance superweapons, what we call the long-distance relationship killer. There are also tons of other interesting properties, but I don't want to go on for too long. To make a computer, you need 2 simple things. Something that can be in 2 different states to represent 0-1, and logic gates. With these 2 things, you can make a computer out of anything, from silicon to dominoes. A handful of computer scientists speculating on the future of technology tried ways to do this with quarks, at least in theory. Remember those quantum numbers I mentioned earlier? Quarks have one that can be in 3 separate states, named after the 3 primary colors, red, green, and blue. They are named that because of many of the properties work analogously like color. Quarks want their color charge to cancel out. This can be done by having one of each color to make white, or have a quark and its anti-quark, such as red and anti-red. In mediating nuclear interactions, quarks can send a gluon with a quark and another anti-quark. Imagine three quarks and a proton. A red quark wants to send a gluon to its blue neighbor. It sends a gluon with one quark containing the original quark's red colored charge, and another quark with an anti-blue color charge. Giving up its red color charge makes it neutral, and removing anti-blue makes it blue. The anti-blue hits the neighboring blue quark, neutralizing it, and then it takes the red color charge from the gluon. The two quarks have now switched charge. The proposal presented here is to make red represent 1 and blue 0. Green goes unused in all these proposals, but can do some interesting things. You can switch between 1 or 0 using gluons, which act like transistors. From this, you can construct any logic gate using the right combination of gluons and a computer from the right combination of logic gates. The highest transistor count is on the order of the hundreds of millions transistors per square millimeter. Using femto engineering, we can imagine fitting a transistor in every nucleon. This allows a theoretical max of 10 to the 21 per cubic millimeter in silicon. Now, every particle physicist listening is probably having a heart attack listening to this. There are so many obstacles needed to overcome. This is nowhere near as simple as I made it sound. There are all kinds of quantum effects that mess with this, not to mention, we don't know of any way to manipulate particles in the way needed. It is beyond our ability right now to know if this will end up being possible, but the point is to show you it could plausibly be done. What I do know for a fact, though, can be done is liking and subscribing so I can make more videos. Also, letting this video replay in another tab so I can get that sweet, sweet watch time. Otherwise, I will find you, and I will appear under your bed, and I will teach you quantum physics. That is a threat.